Welcome to Ideas in Action, the official University of Southern California podcast. This show was recorded live on USC's campus.
Let me introduce our panelists and then off we'll go. Geoffrey Cowan is a university professor, the Annenberg Family Chair in Communication Leadership at USC, a longtime friend, and the author of several remarkable books. The one he will draw on today is entitled Let the People Rule, Theodore Roosevelt and the Birth of the Presidential Primary. Elizabeth Currid-Halkett is the James Irvine Chair in Urban and Regional Planning and Professor of Public Policy here at USC. A recipient of a 2023 Guggenheim Fellowship, she holds the Kluge Chair in Modern Culture at the Library of Congress. She's the author of four books. Her new, scholarly, and often emotionally moving book, The Overlooked Americans, focuses on what she describes as the resilience of our rural towns and what that means for our country. Geoffrey Jenkins is the Provost Professor of Public Policy, Political Science, and Law here at USC. He is also the Maria B. Curther Professor of Citizenship and Democratic Values and directs the Political Institutions and Political Economy Collaborative at USC's Saul Price School. All that suggests that you're very busy. Nonetheless, you found the time to co-author Congress and the First Civil Rights Era, 1861 to 1918, which is a fascinating and often disturbing read. As part of this event, I'm going to reserve the last 15 minutes for audience questions. You'll raise your hands, someone will bring you a microphone, and then you can ask the question. And I don't have to make the announcement about going upstairs and buying an autographed copy of the books, because it's already been made. So let me start by asking each of you individually a specific question and give your co-panelists a chance to comment on your responses. Elizabeth, you argue that rural and urban America share core values, like opposing racism, upholding environmental protection, and cherishing democracy. How do you explain the fact that rural voters seem to lean so heavily toward Donald Trump and the MAGA Republicans, or is that just a stereotype?
Is it working now? Okay. That's a great question, Bob. So one of the things that really kept reoccurring in my mind when I was interviewing Americans was that people are multitudes. All of us are. We are contradictions. We are complicated. And if we can see that in ourselves, I'm not sure why we're surprised that folks in Appalachia or in rural Pennsylvania, where I grew up, would be any different. I think the Trump vote is a straw man, in my opinion. Rural America has been voting and increasingly voting Republican for decades now. And I think that Trump and his cult of personality may make us think, oh my gosh, you know, they're voting for Trump, when actually what they're doing is voting for Republicans. I also think, from talking to a lot of rural Americans, that we ascribe too much emotion to their vote. I think that they went, some of them, of course, are extremely impassioned, so this is a generalization, but an awful lot of them just went and voted for the Republican candidate like they've done every year, and have they have increasingly been doing. And so I guess this is all by way of saying that I don't believe that that's mutually exclusive to caring about our democracy and caring about the environment and understanding that inequality is a real problem in this country. So I think that that's the problem for folks who live in, you know, coastal elite cities, myself included, a card-carrying Democrat, that, you know, you're like, how can you do these two things at the same time? And I think the reality is that it's more complicated. People's vote isn't necessarily their identity in the way that we, and certainly the media, has written it to be.
Jeff and Geoffrey, do you want to comment?
Wow. And in particular, let me ask you, have Democrats and progressives made a mistake by writing off instead of reaching out to rural areas?
Well, Bob, I think when you started in politics, more or less when I did, although you've been much more deeply involved, but a lot of those voters were Democrats. And their lives haven't changed that much. I mean, they, you know, and I think Biden has something in common, for example, with the ethnicity of the being an Irish Catholic and so forth. These were, you know, there was a lot of ethnic, and there are people in the Senate today, for example, John Tester and Joe Manchin, who somehow do manage to reach a lot of those people. So I feel like it should be possible. Maybe the media, which I know we'll talk about later, has made it harder. But I really think that it's part of our, it's not just something we should do because we want to win elections. It's also we should do it for the reasons that your panel suggests, which is that we should bring us together as people.
Geoffrey.
Okay. Elizabeth is right. I think that Tom Frank wrote a book called What's the Matter with Kansas, you know, maybe two decades ago. And he was, at that point, seeing this trend already. So Trump is kind of the culmination of this rather than anything beginning the trend. And Jeff is right, you know, in the Clinton era, a lot of those voters voted Democrat, right? Not even that long ago, right? A little more than a generation ago. I think it's also the case that the media is a problem in this regard, right? Fox News and AON and some others kind of help create these divisions where they may not necessarily exist or would not be obvious in terms of its existence. At the same time, I think it's clear that the elites in the Democratic Party have really not wanted anything to do with these voters and oftentimes use them as a foil for a lot of things. So I think the Democrats at the elite level really pushed against these people. So it's not surprising that they wouldn't be voting Democrat.
Yeah, you know, I was born in southwestern Pennsylvania, though we moved here when I was very young. And my grandfather was a New Deal Democrat who represented the whole area around Uniontown, Connellsville, Bituminous Coal Region in the state legislature. And my stepson took me on a roots trip back about, I don't know, 6-7 years ago. We stayed in Pittsburgh, thank heaven. Connellsville is a completely different place than the place I left as a 7-year-old. The movie theaters are closed. One of them is a junk shop. My grandfather's old house has become a single-room occupancy on the river. My other grandmother and grandfather's house has been knocked down because when the population is cut in half, you know, there's not a lot of market to sell your house. Isn't that feeding some of the discontent? I mean, this whole hollowing out of these communities economically?
You know, Bob, I know that that is the narrative, that this is rural America is angry and has good reason to be. Opioids, poverty, loss of jobs. I work in a policy school. I look at a lot of numbers. I didn't see that. So if you look at Bureau of Labor Statistics and census data on rural America, you see a very different story. The problem, and again, is this the media's fault or our generalizations? Appalachia in a lot of trouble. Parts of the South in a lot of trouble. You know what? The Midwest, great place to live. We are talking about low unemployment rates, high home ownership, median income that is on par with our cities, and in fact, actually more if you consider that the cost of living is so much lower in these places. So this, and also, and I really don't want to get insider baseball here, but if you look at this, even the industries that power our cities, technology, professional services, finance, you can track their spillover into rural America. So what I think, and I always think in sort of solutions as a policy professor, is we need to be more bespoke in terms of our interventions. We need to realize rural America is not, we can't talk about it as a whole. It's more complicated. Parts of the Northeast are doing really well. The Midwest, parts of California are really benefiting from the tech spillover. And yeah, we need to do something for the South in Appalachia. We do. But these are not the same places. It's like comparing Akron, Ohio to Manhattan. I mean, it's apples and oranges.
Yeah, I think that's right. Because where I grew up, where I was born, thank heaven I grew up in Culver City, but where I was born is kind of the very beginning of Appalachia.
Yeah.
And it was solidly Democratic. Now, if you go there, you'll see signs about guns in every yard. You'll see the Ten Commandments posted in house after house after house. So that Appalachia is clearly a different case than If you drive even up through the Central Valley here, and you'll see community, Fresno's thriving now, which is, I think, shocking to some people. Okay, Jeff, for you.
Wait, can I just, before it comes to me, I want to just tell you a little anecdote. So right before the 2016 election, we were going to go to the convention in Cleveland, and I called one of my friends from childhood, who I had known well because he worked at the Youngstown Vindicator, and I used to go out to Youngstown with him all the time. And then he had worked for Governor Rhodes, who was more or less, in today's world, a moderate Republican, and become political consultant. I called this guy up. I said, what should we know that we don't know now is happening there? He said, nobody's reporting about the fact that all around Youngstown, by the way, there's no longer a Vindicator, which is a problem itself, but all around Youngstown, there are Trump signs. And nobody's noticing that. And I think a piece of this whole story is, where is the press? We need to have a press that understands those communities and can report about them honestly and candidly and intelligently.
That leads me straight to my question for you. The presidential primary is the way we now select presidential nominees. And historically, that wasn't the case. And you not only wrote a book about it, you helped make it happen after the disastrous 1968 Democratic Convention. The primaries since then have given us Bill Clinton, George W. Bush, Barack Obama, Joe Biden, and of course Donald Trump. Does the primary process now tend to mend divides or exacerbate them? And if the latter, is that just the price we have to pay for our democracy?
No, I think it's a huge issue, and as you know, I'm starting to work on this. I'm doing a couple pieces for Politico about it. I did have a key role in what you're saying, and interestingly, the book, the Roosevelt book, when it was reviewed in the Washington Post, was reviewed by a historian many people here will know, H.W. Brands, Bill Brands of the University of Texas, and his review in the Washington Post started with the following sentence. This is in January of 2016. He said, if Donald Trump becomes the nominee of the Republican Party, against the wishes of all of the Republican Party leaders, he should send a note of thanks to Geoffrey Cowan. By the way, for those who are wondering, he's not sent that note. But but it isn't because Trump was nominated that I have these questions. The argument that's being made, Bob, and I really want to spend some time really thinking about it, is that the primary process itself takes people to their political corners. And so right now, Trump I know everybody thinks he won't be the nominee. I think excellent chance he will be. But not because he's the most popular person if you have the electorate generally, but because he's the most popular person with the people who vote in Republican primaries. And one of the things that I think is most interesting is, what should the process be by which these things happen? I didn't personally like caucuses. That's a whole other thing we can debate about, because people who worked at night or, you know, had children to take care of couldn't go to the caucuses. But primaries have their own issues, and each state can create their own rules. So, for example, the rules could be to allow independents to vote in either party primary if they wanted. But if you don't allow them to vote...
New Hampshire does that.
Yeah. But if you don't allow them to vote, it takes you to a particular side. Bob, if I could just take one moment of personal privilege, I want to say that this great event, which we're all participating in and enjoying, is really the work of two women who were here with us, and they haven't been properly recognized. And I just, if you're liking this book festival, you should know it was created in, I think, 1996 by Nara Zucchino and Lisa Rialli. They worked at the LA Times. There wasn't the money even to do it. They found their own budgets to do it, to create this festival that's so terrific. And I wonder if you'd join me in congratulating them for this work.
Okay.
I broke us off of our
No,
trip.
No, I don't. But we're no, talking no, I think this is... fabulous, and you told me you were going to do it beforehand.
Yeah, I did. But what the primaries have done, and now there are a lot of things people are thinking about. For example, ranked choice voting is another concept that some people are coming up with that maybe would make a difference. It's kind of amazing to me that Lisa Murkowski lost her primary, didn't she, in Alaska, and one then in a write-in vote.
That was the election before.
Yeah, that's right.
The most recent one.
That's right. But the processes are being, you know, both parties think about how to do it. We've all read now, here we're in, very few people here are college students, but we're in a university here. Some states are trying to make it as hard as possible for university students to vote. Not because they are arguing university students aren't informed, but because of the political impact of having those people vote. And that kind of thing is part of what's distorting the process now in a very serious way, I think.
Primaries, good or bad, as the ultimate arbiter of nominees?
I think better than not, Bob, for the reasons you said. I think we wouldn't have had, and you can go straight through things. We know Jack Kennedy won in West Virginia, where there weren't that many primaries at the time, but that made people think a Catholic could possibly win. Ronald Reagan, who was thought to be an old man, today be considered a child, but people thought, could somebody that old become president? He won partly because of the primaries. And Barack Obama, could a black person possibly win? He won in caucuses and then primaries. I think the primaries are more good than bad, but I think there are a lot of serious questions about how they should be changed.
Do either of you have a comment on that?
I'm a fan of the smoke-filled room myself. Parties are a constellation of different groups. And when those different groups have to organize and coordinate around one person, they have to essentially compromise. And you find somebody who satisfies multiple clienteles.
I completely agree with
you. That's fine. Okay, Geoffrey, this one's for you. Your book reveals not only that America was deeply divided in the era that led up to the Civil War, but the divisions afterwards between parties and then within the GOP itself saw a consensus, almost a consensus emerge, ultimately among the white majority that saw Reconstruction ended, progress stalled, and reversed. Given the proliferating attacks, political attacks now, on wokeness and multiplying caricatures about critical race theory, do we face similar dangers today?
I mean, I certainly think there's a blowback against some progressive ideals and progressive policies. The whites in the Democratic Party are not going to defect and suddenly not remain Democrats any longer. So there's not going to be any kind of coalition by a certain group around anti-wokeness. It's also the case, I think, that I understand the reasons why we think about things like the new Jim Crow or Jim Crow 2.0 when we make references to attacks on voting rights and whatnot. And I think we have to push back against any serious efforts to limit voting rights. But I think when we take those old terms and we try to modernize them, sometimes we play down how important some of the actions in the past actually were. I mean, Jim Crow was legal segregation between the races and clear disenfranchisement throughout the South that reduced turnout by 30 percentage points. We're never going to go back to that. That's never going to happen again.
Either of you?
Well, I'd just like to give the example, and a lot of people here will remember pre-Voting Rights Act, summer of 1964, which I remember vividly in Mississippi. Some of you have heard of the Freedom Democratic Party. In those days, basically African-Americans could not vote in Mississippi. Now I think there may be more elected office holders, African-American elected office holders in Mississippi than there are in any state. Maybe that's not right, but maybe percentage of the population. You know, they're all over as sheriffs and as, and the person who ran the January 6th committee is a congressman from the 2nd District, which, by the way, sort of weird to realize it, but the person who organized Mississippi that summer of 1964 for SNCC was Stokely Carmichael. But amazing that you have a black congressman who we all found to be terrific in running, or I shouldn't say we all did, but I thought was, so it's not quite the, quite, it isn't back to the point that it once was.
The biggest problem in Mississippi, where I did campaigns, and actually helped elect a Democratic governor, a progressive Democratic governor, is that the population is such that you have to get about 39%, 38% of the white vote for a Democrat to be elected. The problem is that in Mississippi, Republican is synonymous with white, and Democrat is synonymous with black. And Benny Thompson's district is very heavily African American. They concentrated lots of African American voters there.
You're speaking of statewide people, and then
statewide's Benny. Tough.
It's tough, but if you go into the individual cities, towns, sheriffdoms, whatever they're called. I don't know the number of cities, Bob. Maybe I'm a little bit wrong. But essentially, there's a surprising number. You're seeing what's happening with Jackson. Isn't it Jackson that they're trying to take away the power?
Yeah, the state legislature is trying to take away power from the city of Jackson.
Right. Where the city of Jackson's controlled essentially by black and somewhat progressive voices. So, you know, what they're doing trying to take the power away is bad. But the fact that Jackson would have a, I'm not going to talk about how competent they are, I don't know. But the fact that they're trying to take the power away from people who are Democrats is a statement of its own.
Okay. Next question's for all of you, and it goes to the heart of what we're talking about today. Polarization has become the strategy of choice for some political leaders. Can we overcome that, and how? Geoff, you want to start?
So I'll start by saying no, we can't. In some sense, we have to think about what polarization actually is. It's significant political division. And when we think about today, oftentimes we think about the middle part of the 20th century as the golden era, right? When the parties reached across the aisle, when you had a good deal of bipartisanship. But if you look across the 200 plus years of American history, that was the exception, not the rule. The rule in the United States is for polarization and intense partisanship. That has been what we normally have. And when we look back to the middle part of the 20th century as a golden era, we have to remember that a lot of that bipartisanship came with Republicans and Southern Democrats joining forces to limit the power of labor and limit the power of race. So I don't think that we should necessarily think of that as a golden era. And if the polarization we see today is simply reflecting the fact that people have very diverse and sometimes divisive preferences, who are we to say that that's not the right thing?
Yeah, the difference for me is that in the 1990s, for example, a Ted Kennedy could go to an Orrin Hatch and say, look, I want to ensure the health of all poor kids in America. And Hatch would say, I don't want it to be a big national program. And Kennedy would say, well, why don't we have it be a federally financed program administered by the states? Hatch said, I go along with that. And as a result, 8 million kids, and probably more than that now, got health coverage, got health insurance coverage. Today, someone like Orrin Hatch would have to say, I'd love to do it, but I don't think I can do it without getting thrown out in a primary. So I think we are,
it is different,
era.
For sure. Yeah.
I think it's kind of recursive as well, though, in the sense that this isn't even my research. This isn't some political scientists who wrote this great book on division. I'm obviously blanking on their names right now in front of a whole crowd of people, where they studied that it was actually only 20% of people who were polarized. That 80% of voters are actually largely in the middle. They don't want to talk about politics at Thanksgiving. They don't really care who you vote for. But we have this very loud, squeaky wheel of polarized voters. There's this other thing going on as well, which is that the structure of our media now is such that polarization is what encourages clicks, encourages selling, encourages attention. And so it doesn't, you know, I'm kind of paraphrasing Barack Obama. It's not a story to say there's these nice folks in Iowa and, you know, they're just having a good day and they don't care what you're doing with your day. That's not a news story, even if it happens to be the truth. And so I think that it's important to keep in mind that some of this is, you know, kind of to quote Marshall McLuhan here, is there is a, you know, the medium is the message here. I mean, if we decide to project a notion of polarization through our various media channels, people will perceive polarization even if you ask them point blank, they would say, I don't feel strongly about this.
And I think if to be fair about this, Bob, the polarization, and this goes to Elizabeth's point, but it's not all coming from one side.
Yeah.
You know, it's easy for people in a room, if people in the room happen to be Democrats or progressives of a certain kind, to think, oh, it's all the Republicans. But the fact is there's plenty of it that's coming from the other side of the aisle, too.
Do you think it's equivalent?
I don't think it's equivalent, but I don't think we should ignore it either.
Okay, I get that. I want to go to something you just said, and that is the talk about the influence of our fragmented media landscape and the prevalence of social media, which together arguably reinforce divides, proliferate conspiracy theories, and shape a society where everybody is entitled not only to their own opinions, but to their own facts. Is there any way to begin to restore a common base of knowledge where we do respect the truth?
I mean, you know, wouldn't it be great if we had some United States version of the BBC? You know, some kind of neutral go-to, everyone turned it on at 7 o'clock at night. It was actually forced to be neutral. We don't have that, but that kind of collective sense of, you know, sharing of information. The other thing I think is really problematic is some of the best journalism in this country is behind a paywall. So some of the folks I interviewed in parts of rural Pennsylvania, you know, rural Kentucky, you know, they were getting their news on like YouTube because they don't have our Facebook. They don't have access to the New York Times. You get like 11 articles, and the Wall Street Journal, I don't know if you even get any. You don't get any from Bloomberg. So I think the news media has a duty to provide more news and information because the high quality stuff is hard to get a hold of. And so then we remain in these silos.
I think another huge problem is the increasing number of what are called news deserts. You know, the death of maybe, I don't know, 1,500 papers around the country. People tend to believe if somebody died in the community, it's true or it's false. I mean, usually. if a basketball team won or lost, you know it. If a wedding is taking place, the things that happen that are local, which local news media report about, which are about your community, you tend to trust your paper. But we're losing those papers. So now, so much of where people are getting their news, even if it's the New York Times or the Washington Post, which I think do a pretty good job, although Marty Baron, you probably saw this recently, read a column kind of criticizing his own successors at the Washington Post. But even assuming that they do a really good job, they're not reporting on the things people know in their own lives.
So again, to be kind of the political historian, for a majority of American history, the press in this country has been partisan.
That's correct.
So it's only fairly recently in the 20th century that we actually had something that is akin to an objective press. And we may not have anything.
And even then, there were always outliers like the Chicago Tribune.
Sure. Yeah. The editorial page of those newspapers.
The news pages of the Chicago Tribune.
Sure.
In the 1930s.
The McCormicks, yeah. So, and, you know, the press will give the people what they want. They're trying to essentially run a business, right? And today, people want to hear what's in their own minds, right?
So if I want to underline the point you're making. When the press that the founders knew, when they said, when they adopted the First Amendment, was a press that was pretty much paid for by political parties and partisan groups. That's what you're saying. It's true. That's what the press was at that time. There became a press, whether it was perfect. And you also had Father Coughlin. You had, everybody here has seen Citizen Kane. You had Citizen Kane, if there's no war, I'll give you one. But that was not the press, interesting, that our founders knew.
So, Elizabeth, I want to follow up with you. You say it's terrible that you have all these paywalls, but how would the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal assemble, or the Washington Post, assemble the kind of staffs that they have and do the kind of work that they do when, in fact, we're heading to the day, I think, when there will probably not be paper editions of those papers. They'll just be on the Internet. And if you make them free.
No, you're not wrong. I mean, there's some balance, obviously. I think it's important to observe that our best journalism is out of reach for most of America. Whether it's through cultural capital, as in they're not even aware of how to access it, or whether when they try to, they hit a, you need to subscribe for $10 a month or whatever it is. And that's a lot of money to a lot of people in this country. So I don't know what it is. Is it, you know, people should be getting five from every major, you know, five articles from every, I don't know. There's got to be something, though, that we can do.
And the Dominion case, let me just remind people, I think many of us are sorry we didn't have 6 weeks of trial. That would have been a great theater, too. But we know from the information that came out through the discovery that Fox was scared of its own viewers. They wouldn't tell the truth. And the guy who called Arizona correctly was fired by Fox.
Yeah.
So I would just ask you, Bob, or ask you in a rhetorical sense, right? I mean, we have so many different ways to get information now, right? We don't have to rely upon a few gatekeepers in the press, right? We can read Substacks, we can read blogs, we can follow on Twitter and Facebook, right? We have the small d democratization of information and news. Isn't that a good thing?
I think it has both good and bad effects. We've had a democratization of politics in some ways and fundraising. Barack Obama could not have been the Democratic nominee without the money that he raised on the internet. But the example I always think of is if a producer had gone to Walter Cronkite, and most people here probably remember him, the dean of American journalism, the gold standard, had gone to him in 1962 and said, you know, there's a group called the John Birch Society, and they're holding a press conference today to say that President Eisenhower was an agent of the communist conspiracy and President Kennedy is a socialist. How many camera crews do you want to send? Cronkite would have looked up at him and said, you're fired. I mean, we had gatekeepers, and gatekeepers did serve a function. So that, you know, it was ABC to some extent, but certainly CBS, NBC, the New York Times, the Washington Post. That spawned an earlier conspiracy theory that all the media were liberal, and the conservatives could never get a fair shake from the media. But having gatekeepers did make a difference. Look, in 1960, Kennedy and Nixon could debate Medicare for the aged under Social Security. And Kennedy was for it, Nixon was against it, Nixon was for an alternative program. But Nixon certainly didn't offer alternative facts like, well, actually, older people are not challenged in terms of their health care costs. Today, people would say that. I mean, you could find almost anything said almost anywhere, somewhere in those Substacks. I mean, look at QAnon. So, I get the fact that there are certain benefits. There are also clearly certain problems with this.
That's the way it is with democracy, yeah. Right, in general.
Well, if you were earlier talking about other times in American history which have been polarized and difficult, and we were talking a little earlier about our friend Adam Hochschild, who wrote a book called American Midnight. And that period, which was just about exactly 100 years ago, you look at America at that period, which you write about in your books, the viciousness, the hatred, what was happening in this country was horrible. And there have been many of those times. You know about the middle 50s, are they so great? Well, all right. I don't know how many people here have any conscious memory still of McCarthyism. But I knew kids. I grew up in New York. I knew kids whose parents couldn't carry on their living because they were not allowed to work because somebody thought they were communists. There was a publication called Red Channels, you know. So there have been some pretty horrible times in our lives in the past.
The early cancellation period, we could call it, right? In some way,
unscheduled early cancellation. Elizabeth, let me start with you on this. Can you assess the role of religion and the fact that two of the most religious groups in the country, African Americans and evangelicals, either seem to have very different values or apply their religious values in very different ways and pretty uniformly vote for very different parties?
So I don't feel like I'm an expert with regard to the black experience with religion, and I did do a lot of interviews with evangelicals in America. But I think what I can comment on with regard to the role of religion, because I think it's such an important topic and one has to be respectful about it, so I don't want to just start pontificating about what I don't know. But what I do know is that religion plays a very different role in urban America, or shall I say coastal America and rural America. And what I mean by this is religion in rural America has enormous cultural and social capital. It is not just your religion. I am going to church. I believe in God. I practice a certain way. It is your community. It is what you talk about. It is whom you rely upon. And it becomes the focal point of community life in rural America. Whereas in urban America, particularly in our global cities, religion is one of many sources of cultural capital and social capital. And so it becomes quite diluted in its role in that way. And that is something that I found really quite profound in my study of this country, was its really different roles in these different geographies.
There's a statistic that I saw the other day, and maybe you know it, Bob, and can drill into it, but about the percentage of people in Congress who are consider themselves deeply religious versus the percentage of the public generally. Maybe one of you knows those numbers.
I don't know the numbers, but I can tell you that.
Well, I know from looking at the University of Chicago's General Social Survey that urban and rural Americans, when interviewed, have about the same distribution in terms of their religiosity and in terms of the degree of religiosity, which is that something like, I'm throwing this out, but I think it's something like 50%, whereas it's a much more overt practice in rural America than it is in urban America.
Yeah, Jeff, I would just say I think it would be most members of the House and the Senate would consider it to be politically not wise, but very foolish to put down no religion.
Yeah, so you don't know if you trust those results. That's possibly true too.
Yeah.
Bob, you know, you're talking about the split within the evangelical community, but how about the split within other communities? I mean, certainly it's true within the Jewish world. You and I have been talking about that. And I think it's true within the Catholic world too. There are plenty of splits within religious, you know, just within religious.
Yes, and I would wonder if you put a template over that, a geographical template, if it wouldn't make a difference.
Yeah.
Rural, say, versus the coasts, rural versus Chicago, you know, because sometimes we all forget that the third biggest city in America happens, or it's now fourth, the fourth biggest city in America happens to be in the middle of the country. Yeah. And Houston and Dallas have now become Democratic cities.
I grew up in Chicago. I didn't realize it was fourth now.
I think it's
right?
Fourth. I think Houston's third.
Okay. Yeah. I'm going to still say third, though.
Well, I remember when it was second still.
That's why. Let's stick with
okay,
second.
I'm going to do a final question from me and then turn it over to the audience. Are you hopeful or discouraged about where America will be in 10, 15 years, given the divides that now seem so deep and given the anger that now seems so real? Who wants to start?
I guess I would say I'm realistic, right? I think it'll probably continue. It'll probably be similar to this. I think the stock market will recover and will be doing very well as a country in terms of GDP. So I tend to try to put a lot of these things in a box, right? Some things in this country aren't great, but some things are great.
This week's Economist, by the way, has an extraordinary article about how America is the most successful thriving economy in the world, way outpacing its competitors, which, of course, is not what people believe if you ask them in public opinion polls. Go ahead.
I'm extremely hopeful when I talk to Americans. I think it's hard not to be. I've talked to dozens and dozens of Americans across this country, and I just feel that we are, as people, are amazing and weather great storms and have an enormous belief in each other. And I just wish we could figure out as a society how to get that across to everyone, because if we understood that most of us feel the same way, then I think we'd be okay. I really do. I don't mean to be cliche here or a Hallmark card. I really mean it. I didn't talk to a single American anywhere in this country who spoke any hatred, any vitriol. They were wonderful, warm people. And I just, that sounds like the people I'm friends with too. So I think that's really important for us to figure out a way to get that out there.
Jeff?
Let me say two things about it. First of all, I loved it and kind of wanted to believe it when Barack Obama used that phrase of Martin Luther King's about the arc of the universe is long and it blends toward justice. I thought, yeah, as Barack Obama's president, I believe that. Maybe I then didn't quite feel so much that way with the next president. Maybe I feel a little bit more that way. But, you know, Bob, there are so many other factors at work. We're talking about some here. There's the world at play. You're talking about this Economist piece which talks about how fabulous our economy is, and it's probably a surprise to China. But it is. China itself has some serious problems. But China is a major force in the world, and I think what they're doing is very interesting. China, all of a sudden, is eclipsed by India. And by the way, what's happening out in outer space? And what's happening with the scientific revolution? When's the next COVID thing? So we can have our hopes, and I'm going to remain hopeful, and maybe it's partly because, you know, all four of us get to teach students, and that's something that makes you hopeful. That's one of the reasons I think we all teach. But the truth is we don't know what's out there. And what's out there could be something that's wonderful that all makes us feel better, or it could be something, holy cow, I didn't see 9/11 on the horizon.
Okay, we're going to take questions from the audience. Raise your hands, and someone will bring you a microphone. Let's take a microphone.
Wow. Okay, there we go. I sound amazing. I want to go back to, somewhere I heard that somewhere in the 1880s, the Republicans basically pushed through, the Republican Party pushed through the Dakotas, three other states, to basically kind of get their power entrenched. For
Dakota was going to be one state. They divided it into two states to get more senators.
Okay, yeah. So, and then now since then, we have basically had these tiny states, which, if you look at the balance, Texas versus California, New Hampshire versus some, but all told, you guys know the numbers. If you look at the total number of population that is represented by Democrats, usually there's like a $20, $40, $50 million person difference, you know, among the total population. So it seems like there's this inculcated power balance, which goes back so far, which a small number of people, for all the reasons you know, you talked about, have learned how to exploit just enough for that 10-20%. So I'm wondering, you know, also like to finish up, you know, our vote versus the number of senators we have is huge versus Wyoming. So with that inherent power balance, what can we do in absent like a constitutional convention or eliminating the Electoral College? Where does that go?
I have strong views on this, but one of you want to, I would be terrified of a constitutional convention. We might decide to, you know, somehow or other get an amendment. And remember that 3/4 of the states would approve the amendments or the new constitution. I mean, we could get stuff in there that would be not a very good idea, number one. Number two, I don't think it's 20 to 40 million. I mean, I think the 2020 election is probably a pretty good proxy. It's probably Democrats 7-8 million more than Republicans. And number three, we're not going to solve this, in my view, institutionally. Democrats or progressives, if you happen to be one, are going to have to fight like hell to win purple states. Now, they got a lot of help from the Supreme Court a year ago. And that explains why 2022 was not a red tsunami, but a red trickle. But I don't think there's any institutional solution to this. And by the way, because we always talk, go back to the beginning, it was true at the beginning. I mean, the Constitutional Convention consciously gave two senators to Rhode Island and two senators to New York, and there was a big population disparity, and it was to get the smaller states to not think that they would simply be swallowed up if they joined the Union.
If we wanted to look back to the founding fathers, or the they were fathers, the founding group, so many of the things they did were what we would call undemocratic on the basis you're talking about. Bob's talked about one, which is sort of a portion of that kind. How many women could vote? You know, one thing after another, how much were, not only could not African Americans couldn't vote, but they weren't even treated as a full person in the population counts. So there were all of these things that were actually in the, you know, the founding parents did. And yet we, you know, there's so much wonderful that they did. But a lot of the stuff you're talking to, I think as Bob is saying, was actually in the documents when they were originally adopted.
It had to be, or they wouldn't have been ratified. Next question.
This one here.
Okay, right there.
Okay. I'm a bit of a skeptic about us being able to mend our democracy, and I'm on this basis. My wife and my first trip post-COVID was to Idaho. The central lesson that I learned there was they don't understand us and we don't understand them. Now, if you take the premise of mutual understanding as the basis, and forgive me for using your first name, Elizabeth, you've traveled and spoken to a few dozen people. There are 332 million of us. How can we have an interchange between 332 million people when we're here and they're there? And that, in my view, is really the only real basis of really starting to get back together is to understand our commonality.
Well, I think that's an excellent question. First, it was more than a few dozen. I am a social scientist, and there's a couple of things going on here. So first of all, I understand where you're coming from, and I think people have those experiences. There's two ways that I came to this conclusion. One is through data, like looking at, and I alluded to it, the General Social Survey out of the University of Chicago, where they interview people on their opinions on myriad different social, economic, cultural issues. And what you find are that on most issues, urban and rural America respond exactly the same. It's kind of extraordinary. I redid my analysis three times because I didn't believe it. Except that then I started talking to people and I realized that actually those interviews that were done by the GSS, those questions that folks answered, corroborated what I was finding when I talked to Americans. So one thing I think we need to be careful about is we're always going to run into people who have extreme views or who say, I don't get the coasts, or folks at our dinner table in Los Angeles, you say, oh my gosh, rural Americans, like what do they know? We're always going to run into folks like that. But you've got to find the through line. Like what's going on with most people? And I think with most people, we don't have a problem with other people unless they hurt us or our family or our friends. And we don't really strongly care about what they do with their lives. And I think, I feel like I'm wading into waters that I'm not familiar with. So Jeff, you're going to have to jump in a second, and Bob. But, you know, I think Trump has turned this on its head in the sense that, you know, we alluded to the fact that our press has always been partisan. Well, partisan isn't exactly the same thing as polarized. I mean, of course we lean one way or the other. You vote Republican versus Democrat. I think that Trump came in and he kind of made us he disrupted the system. So if a different Republican came in and more people voted for that person, would we be having this conversation today in the same way? That's actually my question.
In Idaho. Let me pick what I think is an Idaho example. Isn't it, and Bob, you may know this, but didn't Idaho make it a crime to leave the state to get an abortion?
Yes.
How common would that view be among people in those, say, in this room and in that state? Not whether you should be able to have an abortion in Idaho, but you can't even leave the state to have an abortion.
That's probably unconstitutional, but...
But it reflects, I'm just going to your point, it seems to reflect the point of view of some people in Idaho and maybe a majority who voted for it.
I think it's a huge result of the gerrymandering that has been done of these state legislatures. Salt Lake City, the Utah legislature, is now divided into pieces of it to three congressional districts, because there was always the danger and sometimes the reality that it would elect a Democrat to Congress. And my guess is, and I don't know what time you spent in Idaho, my guess is that that's not the majority opinion in Idaho, but that it is the opinion among the activists who dominate Republican primaries in these state legislative districts. I mean, look at what happened with the abortion reproductive rights referenda last year.
Right. I mean, Kansas.
Kansas.
I was just going to bring up Kansas.
Yeah, I mean, it overwhelming.
Yep.
So I think it's more a reflection of the gerrymandering of our politics, the primary process as it exists in these states.
One of my colleagues here at USC, one of our colleagues here at USC, John Matsusaka, who's in the business school, thinks that one of our big problems is we don't have anything like a national referendum. We're one of only two countries, Israel being the other country, that doesn't take the country's temperature on big issues. And it could be, we could have a referendum that may not necessarily have policy consequences, but it would be nice to be able to ask Americans in a regular basis what they think about particular topics.
Okay, another question?
Go for it.
You have customers over here. Anybody have a mic?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, one of the things you guys talked about, which is a claim that gets made pretty often, is that the American public is very polarized and divided. I'm always curious when that claim gets made, by what exact metric are we polarized? Because like 55% of voters support Medicare for All, 59% the PRO Act, which strengthens labor and union protections. 6 in 10 adults say they favor raising the federal minimum wage to $15, and 27%... most of Americans don't trust the mainstream media. And just anecdotally, like the people that I talk to generally seem to have an increasing distrust in any side of the political establishment. So I'm wondering, like, what metrics are we polarized according to? What do you guys think about that?
Well, we typically look at, so polarization in Congress is based upon roll call votes. The two parties just diametrically vote against one another on a regular basis. We usually do public opinion polls of elites to conventions, activists and conventions, and they're quite a bit different than they were 30 years ago. And even regular Americans, while not nearly as polarized as those two other groups, are showing more differences in public opinion polls over time.
Yeah, I would just add, it's the same thing I was talking about earlier. An Orrin Hatch, Republican from Utah, wouldn't agree today, assuming he wanted to run for re-election, to co-sponsor a national health insurance